every day of the week.
It's actually 105 just in case there's a rounding error. Yeah. That way it's still above 100. Extra. But we do have the Rumble band away, FlyQuest. They played it themselves last time. They don't want to find it this
time. There you go, there you go.
I have been saying it. He's going to be pick or ban if he gets through the bans. Blue team, you better be locking him in now. Right. He can struggle in some specific counter matchups. He can also struggle against ranged top laners. But we'll see how Team Liquid and Impact want to deal with what I'm assuming is most likely Bwipo playing this in the top lane. Obviously still viable as a jungler, but we have been seeing a lot more of it in top lane recently.
Now, these hovers for Team Liquid actually tell a story of their own flowers.
Yes, sir.
The first one was that Tristana that I was talking about when they were the ones who banned away Cassio, raises your Tristana profile. The second one, the Twisted Fate, is one of my favorite picks into top lane Skarner.
Yep.
Both because you can abuse the range part of the matchup, but mainly because my favorite counter to Skarner has just been range point and click CC, because you can just stun him out of his E. Whenever he's trying to whenever he's trying to get an engage onto you, and it really helps a lot towards later stages of the game too, to be able to play cross map.
Yep.
So those hovers from Team Liquid were pretty packed with a lot of information there, and they do end up blocking the Tristana. Kind of what I was talking about.
Yeah, it shows that they know what they need to do into this champion. Ornn guy is obviously very happy
right
again.
So what's at the casting booth, by the way?
Ornn guy's popping off. He's got the horn ready to go. All right, the Ornn horn sounding off here in the lobby.
Gave him my mic.
Yeah, no, Kobe's the real MVP here popping off. The support for the carry that is Ornn guy. But speaking of supports and carries, we got the Senna Ornn duo locked in again for the bot lane of FlyQuest. I think that Busio is clearly MVP for them last game. He was responsible for that big engage that broke the big TL lead and had a lot of good follow-ups throughout the rest of the game. TL likely to put Umti back on the Maokai here again in this game.
And another good story from a hover there, which was a Mordekaiser hover, which is another one of the counter picks to Skarner on top lane that has emerged. And I also always really like Mordekaiser being able to take like an Ornn or something out of a team fight. So a couple of nicely little options there, but in the end, they go with a very similar pickup. Okay. The Tristana in place of the Corki, compounded with a Maokai. Last time around, you know, the buffs to AP junglers with the Faded Ashes build path has been so nice. And so Maokai going Liandry's provides a lot of AP. It provides some good clear for the Maokai. All AP junglers have really good clear right now just because you can build that item so early on. And it does give you that massive bonus damage to monster camps. Meanwhile, we got to catch up on the bans here.
Yes, sir.
Seraphine, you'll be happy to know, banned out by the Skarner side.
We follow lore at all.
We don't have the beef anymore. There's not really any beef.
They changed the lore?
Yeah, lore is all different. I'll give you a crash course sometime.
Okay,
we're pretty much, we beef with other people. Skarner beefs with everybody now. She no longer has beef priority.
Okay.
I'll put it that way.
Okay. So Seraphine's off the hook. Looks like FlyQuest saw the Mordekaiser and they were like, we're more worried about the Mordekaiser counterpick than we are the Twisted Fate counterpick, so. They opt to ban that side of it instead.
All right. So Mordekaiser, Seraphine, Viego, Huey, all banned out. Team Liquid, who are we going to see here for this fourth pick of the draft? Is it just going to be the Zac picked top again? It looks like we might see that same top jungle combination for lots of CC, lots of engage potential. So Zac and Skarner are most likely top lane head-to-head here.
Yeah, we're getting pretty similar setups here from both sides. Obviously, the big adjustment is going to be your Skarner pick. And the trade now.
Ooh.
Because of that.
Hell yeah, that's a good sign. I like that sign. It's a badass sign. All right, so we got Corki. Corki versus Trist. You're talking about the premier AD mid laners. Well, there you go. You got them both.
Uh-huh.
Final pick here for FlyQuest. What are we going to see? I saw some people, I was checking threads, checking posts in between the games. People were pretty critical of Inspired's Mark farming in the previous game on the Kindred, not exactly hitting crazy thresholds on that. But it's Karthus locked in for Fly. Just farm him. Yup. If it's alive, it needs to be dead.
Golden experience. Don't have to worry about where to go for marks. And you can just get those ultimates and high value damage off in every single fight.
Ooh, we've got Kalista AShe in the bottom lane for Team Liquid. Lots of threat on Nista. Do you think we might end up seeing a lane swap again?
I mean, we very much could. I personally hope that we don't. But yeah, we definitely could. I mean, when you have Kalista AShe, it's obviously brutal super early on. So we will keep track of both teams looking at the level ones, see if they can get some deeper information. You know, the deep lane swap wards, perhaps. Move in for your level one and try and get that off. The other thing to keep in mind, and I always mention this when you're bringing up lane swaps, junglers can be some of the biggest beneficiaries of lane swaps, especially Karthus.
Yeah.
Especially Brand, especially these AP junglers.
They farm so fast.
They're just turbo right now with the faded. I'd say some of the easier things to clean up, some of the positioning here for the team fights, and even for the objectives, like prior to the team fights, losing out key members before those even came to become an issue. Now we're gonna see everybody come on up though. Look at this bottom side of the mini map. Team Liquid are gonna head up the river for a little bit of a party.
And APA and CoreJJ are gonna be the ones to face check the brush. APA
got better ARAM.
Losing the most health. Now FlyQuest is gonna find themselves in a pincer attack from Team Liquid, but TL still gotta be worried about these health bars. APA down to 300, CoreJJ at about 200. The AShe still trying to get out. A little bit more poke comes through. The heal forced, Team Liquid, critically low on health, has to keep running. Bwipo and Inspired still gonna chase these guys down. Remember, Bwipo does have that Q, he can keep throwing those rocks. Does not have an incredibly long range, but can still contribute a little bit of extra damage. No more to be found, FlyQuest win the early scrap.
Inspired got a Dark Harvest stack off of CoreJJ as well. Plus they got the flash, plus they get the invade here for the Karthus farming, so this is a very good ARAM start for FlyQuest to be able to get this Karthus farming. Now Umti has to get a little bit dangerous. He's gonna walk over to the other side, so he's gonna be able to start up Raptors a little bit later and a little bit less healthy. And they get a little bit of a lane swap here for themselves as well, so they can try and avoid that brutal double hail of blades, double marksman that we just talked about to the ends of the earth every single day, basically, at MSI.
Yeah.
And FlyQuest at least will be able to avoid that. But once again, the changes on this patch, 75% now the damage reduction on topside turrets in the early 5 minutes of the game, plus your first turret bonus gold has been doubled from 150 up to 300. So if the double hail of blades, AShe and Kalista laying down here, can get all the way through the turret, then you get a bigger reward for your opponents trying to do that lane swap.
And it's not a complete lane swap coming out of the side of FlyQuest, just Massu moving up to top to lane with Bwipo.
Nobody has smite for this.
Yeah, it's just gonna be Inspired trying to guarantee that he takes it, and he does. Umti not fast enough on the Bramble Smash. Inspired gonna feel great about that. When you were talking about Karthus in the jungle, if you can get those little advantages, he's already up 16-8 in the jungle camps, having a couple of extra little bits of tempo early on in the game.
Yeah, it has completely warped this game. Starting out with everybody mid, it had until this point where he gets chunked out, allowed Busio a lot of extra experience. Meanwhile, on the other side, Impact also gonna receive some rocks to the face as Skarner charges him into the wall.
And it's so dangerous to be next to the wall against new Skarner. You have to think about it in the same way as if you were playing against Poppy or Graves. Any champion that takes advantage of a wall bang like that, Skarner can just point blank range, slam you into the wall with E, and it's so dangerous, man. The burst trade is incredibly powerful.
So, our Karthus did enemy red and Raptors and then came down for his blue and then all the way crossing to contest his own red, which he got, by the way, and defend on that bottom side as well. Then goes back up to top side Scuttlecrab here and continues his first round clearing to meet up with Umti towards his top side, where the top side has been brutal with Bwipo continually slamming level one Impact into the wall. Now is gonna have Inspired also steal away these Krugs. So yeah. Karthus farming is gonna be ahead three camps as Umti tries to finish up Raptors and tries to make it only two camps.
And Bwipo is playing this so aggressively against Impact. He knows he's level three against level one and the Zac cannot do anything to him. But now back in the bottom lane,
Yeon and CoreJJ are going to try to use the power of this double marksman, double Halo Blades lane.
Oh, Bwipo
finding
wall
another
again.
Slam back into the wall. He might have flashed over, but there's still too much trouble here for Impact. It's first blood over to Inspired, and Bwipo served it up on a silver platter.
We have finally answered the question, how many times do you have to slam Zach into the wall before you can actually kill him? And it was five we saw on screen. Five times plus a Karthus, and then you can finally kill the Zach.
Nicely done from FlyQuest, getting that one started. Flash for flash up there between the top laners. If you go even on summoner spells and you still accomplish your goal, you're feeling pretty good. So FlyQuest, going to enjoy that one. Meanwhile, talking about flashes, Massu in the bottom lane, forced back underneath the turret. You mentioned how early on that bit of a lane swap technique was used to try to avoid the pressure, the power of this double marksman. But now it's the FlyQuest bot lane who are unfortunately staring down the very same barrel.
And honestly, if they can just keep this pressure up, keep getting turret plate money, get closer and closer to a first turret bonus gold cash in, that is the dream. But the Karthus, I think, is going to be an issue here. Remember, he also got early Dark Harvest stack, so I assume, let me see if he got one off of the Zac as well. Should be two. Yeah, he has two Dark Harvest stacks for his name now as well as the extra kill gold. So you see just Zork Shoes upgrade rush here first for Inspired. Just allows the Karthus with the extra move speed to cruise between the camps and delivers a very high impact level one. But now, Bwipo,
he's trying to get away. Notice how they're standing in between him and the wall, so he can't try to tunnel through it. Bwipo's trying to get out, but Team Liquid's got the lockdown. Bwipo wants to take one with him, but it ain't gonna happen. APA gets paid.
So both teams with the standard kill on the enemy seventh camp of top lane we have become accustomed to in the series. Both top laners going down. Massu with a lot of spears in him, but Inspired's here again.
Inspired ready to try to turn the tides here in the bot lane, 2v2.
They're too low.
But Yeon and Core, they don't care. Yon's going in. Needed one more shot on either enemy player, but he ain't going to find it. Inspired instead getting the kill back on Core. Quad will arrive to guarantee that Yeon ain't getting out of this one. Yeon just trying to see maybe he can bring one of these guys with him. Yeon doesn't have his flash. Yeon doesn't have his heal. Yeon doesn't have any way out. He's going home in a body bag, and nobody's going with him. FlyQuest, 3-1 game.
Well, 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 Flowers. It looks in the early minutes of this game like FlyQuest want to make the most out of this best of three and not go home with a 0-2 start to the LCS. This is a massive, massive lead for a Karthus jungle, which is going to make problems for every single person on the map very shortly. That is now four stacks on the Dark Seal that Inspired invested his money early in. That Zac money was put to good use and it got paid back on bottom lane, which is kind of the only early spot for TL that is supposed to have like a really big gold lead and supposed to have a lot of pressure. They effectively nullified that only early part of your composition with this huge Karthus, and that's gonna continue with the grubs.
Team Liquid, their composition has three marksmen. If Karthus gets really far ahead of the game, he's already 3-0. He's already really far ahead. Yeah. Karthus does this again, gets up to 5 or 6 kills. He presses R. All those marksmen lose half health before the fight even begins.
Yep, with the Sword Shoes rush, with the magic penetration, all these marksmen gonna be half health with one ultimate, and if they take any damage from anywhere else, they'll be toast. So.
Yep.
Meanwhile, APA trying to get a little help there from Impact in mid lane. Doesn't really do anything to Quad. He's farming away his call as well. Rushed the early steel caps there for the matchup of the double ADs in mid. So wants to keep all the pressure off of him while he just pops the call.
Yeah, mid lane feels a lot more handshaky this game. Last time around, everybody, they were both just trying to knock each other out the entire time. This time around, all right, cool, we'll farm it. No big deal. We're both on these very, very powerfully scaling marksman champions in mid lane. But now up here in topside, it's Bwipo and Massu working together to get themselves some turret plates. Bwipo is level 7. Impact is level 4.
Look at this. LCS on live patch. Try this at home. I would say try the Karthus side of it.
You want to be Skarner. You don't want to be Zach right now.
Yeah.
Zach is in some trouble. He gets slammed back into the wall. Bwipo's just trying to bury him in damage. The Requiem sings his demise, and Bwipo finds himself in a 1v2. APA and Umti making an even trade. FlyQuest still up a couple hundred gold, but it's Team Liquid taking the first turret here in the bottom lane to get things a little bit closer.
Yep. Meanwhile, though, mid lane is wide open, so Quad gets to farm up some turret plates there as well for the Corkster. Meanwhile,
Corkster.
Gotta have a little fun here because going pretty far the other way, but TL, let's see what else they can get back here. At least APA gonna get some two up on the top side. Oh my goodness. Flowers, this Karthus is just going to be the story. He even is able to cleanly finish the clear up to another wave that's been pushed up to the tower and had collected another extra bit of gold off the second Zac kill. Five Dark Harvest stacks now after the ultimate.
Yeah, his score is the same as his bounty, 4-0-0. This man is absolutely rich in this game. For the Maokai, it feels pretty bad. This dude is outpacing you, he's outganking you, he is outplaying you so far.
Yeah, there's not much you can do in that scenario. Luckily, at least he can also build the Faded Ashes, so both of them have the extra
help there. There you go. I also get the OP item.
Yeah, just that the Karthus also has like five other very strong partial items there and six stacks on the Dark Seal. But
we don't worry about that.
Umti is focused on the objectives here. Collect the dragon for Team Liquid. Again, this game is not out of your reach. Yeah, it's really annoying to deal with a fed Karthus, but it is not the end of the world. We saw how close the last game went and how long the last game went.
Yep.
It's just that the comps there, they have a little bit less of the possible scaling options. When you invest in a Kalista Ashe lane, it is not exactly supposed to start out with this sort of setup.
All right, Bwipo arming his rock, but does not want to commit to E. Remember that your rock timer pauses while you're in your Ishtal impact charge, so you can easily grab the rock, go for your charge, no matter what the timer feels like, you'll still be able to start getting those smell what the rock is cooking auto attacks. APA gonna keep Quad stuck back underneath the turret, just sort of flashing those emotes, trying to dare him in a little bit.
Well, he's made a good use of the E so far this game, as we've seen impact on the receiving end so many times. Meanwhile, Team Liquid doing the intelligent thing here, rotating their duo lane up into the mid lane so they can try and make use of the power duo while they still can. Infiltrating enemy jungle, getting the deep jungle vision. You want to keep track of that Karthus farming. Maybe you can interrupt it on one of the rotations there. Try and make your incision into the jungle, put a stop to it, at least put him under some pressure.
APA recognizing, okay, don't want to deal with this Karthus. 4-0-0. Do not want to mess with this guy. Team Liquid taking control over the top side river right now. Remember that they didn't get any of that first set of grubs. Okay, here comes the TP. Busio ready for that, but it ain't going to work. He gets stunned up, so he can't use the second half of the Ornhorn. Yeon just barely doesn't get grabbed by the Skarner E, now trying to get away. Meanwhile, the Requiem coming down. APA's in some danger, flashing away, trying to keep the disengage angle alive. He's stuck in the pit. It ain't going to happen. He's shut down, and Quad's the dude taking the money. Now back in the mid lane, CoreJJ is going to get locked up yet again. Bwipo goes for the ulti, and he finds one. Yon's trying to run, but Bwipo takes him out anyway. FlyQuest got themselves a 6-3 game.
Ooh, the Skarner ultimate trumps the Kalista ultimate there. Yoinks him right back in. They get the extra kill. And with APA, I want to click on him to try and see what the cooldown on the rocket jump was there, because he invested the flash to avoid the damage and get deeper into the pit, but then had no way of getting outside of the pit. So maybe in replay we can see on the W cooldown or see if he can get an E reset to try and get an explosion to try and get his W reset. But let's take a look here, because it started out with the Skarner engage onto Yeon, onto the Kalista, which got pretty low. But then our attention towards the APA side, he flashed away from the Busio charge. But yeah, I guess we don't have the information on screen here as far as the W cooldown. So then flash plus a kill on the Tristana is even better. And then Bwipo is able to answer here. Boom! Gets off the Skarner ultimate on the Kalista. As Kalista had ulted CoreJJ, Core survives, but Kalista does not.
Yeah, once Skarner starts charging that animation, you are not interrupting his ultimate. I think it's one thing that some players don't fully respect and recognize yet, is that is inevitable, right? It is Thanos Skarner, and he is going to snap anybody that's in range of that thing. So right now, Bwipo, he has that Winter's approach building towards Fimbulwinter. This is kind of the core item for top lane Skarner that you usually see, and it's very, very powerful on him.
Yep, certainly is. So much sustained defense there with a constant shield, easily able to proc it on the Skarner. Meanwhile, Team Liquid, even though it looked pretty rough there. They lost the flash and the kill onto APA. They also lost their kill onto Yeon. They can kind of say that before the replay started, it was nice that they got their kill on Karthus and cut down on the Dark Seal stacks at least a little bit, but that doesn't really slow Karthus down that much.
Oh, here we go. The Ornhorn summoned up, throwing Yeon up into the air, and Quad is ready to knock him down. FlyQuest. They find their pick. It's going to translate into a tier one turret take here in the mid lane at the same time. Inspired is stealing away the whole enemy jungle. The Karthus is up 40 far.
Yeah, that just continues. That's right. So if you get any sort of lead on this, then you just turbo farm both sides. And you see there, he was counter jungling and then came over for pressure, even soaked two turret shots in order to force CoreJJ into a worse position. So then CoreJJ had to end up flashing and loses another summoner spell on the side of Team Liquid. Flowers, after our banger opener to this series, this one a lot more muted, because both teams know there is just this giant dread hanging over the side of TL where they're like, oh my, this Karthus is level 11 already, by the way.
Yeah.
Level 2 ultimate is going to be coming in quite hot.
He is tied for highest level in the game with both mid laners. He has his Liandry's on top of the Sork Shoes that you were already talking about, so the extra burn on top of the Dark Harvest that's gonna hit you. This guy hits like a truck. Team Liquid looking to force this Drake before FlyQuest has a way to answer. They're still on the approach. Even if they can't contest the objective, they maybe want to try to find a punish, but the Maokai ulti has already set it up for Team Liquid to fire back. Busio here soaking damage on the front line, but now Bwipo is joined up with the rest of FlyQuest. Team Liquid, they don't want the honest 5v5. They're going to back away with the Drake as their prize.
As a smart lesson from Team Liquid to FlyQuest of the importance of those small timings of pushing waves, the reason they were confident in burning the dragon, Bwipo was under tower on the wave that Team Liquid had previously pushed on bottom side of the map. So then with that kind of like pseudo vision, extra pressure of the wave, they burn down dragon. They even give a bit of extra damage and Maokai ultimate here in order to burn the cleanse and force the rest of FlyQuest away. Then, as the Skarner's coming over, they respect the extra member there, and TL, despite being at the deficit, were able to maneuver themselves into dragon number two. Dropping Herald in mid here is not gonna get it. CoreJJ's got nothing.
CoreJJ, he overplays his hand yet again, and he's going to be left behind now. He even uses the barrier. Core, why are we using the barrier there, buddy? He is dead to rights. They get the free pick. Skarner ulti doesn't connect onto Yeon. The Kalista flash used to get him away to safety and not end up a double kill for FlyQuest.
Yeah, only slight thing I would say there is that Bwipo should have waited until Busio finished his second part of his Horn ultimate to then use it on Kalista.
Yeah.
Bwipo coming in did a good job. You know, the circle looked weird on Skarner, but it forced the Kalista flash. And then Kalista with no flash hit him with the Ornn ultimate into Skarner ultimate to guarantee it, but he went a little bit early, just kind of reaching for it. A lot of times with Skarner, you gotta have that trust in your teammates that they will hit the setup CC for you, so then you can look like the god and yoink him in with your ulti.
Exactly. The trade-off with Skarner's ulti now having the bigger AoE and the multi-targets is it's no longer point and click. You've got to have teammates usually to set that up, or you set it up yourself by slamming him into the wall with E. But now Quad's got to back up here in the bottom lane. It's Team Liquid sending a few guys down just in case the Corki got too audacious, tried to push forward a little bit too far. The TP from FlyQuest. We're going to send Quad up into the top side now. Impact still only level 9, has a Sunfire cape at least on the Zac. Finds a little bit of quick burst there onto Quad. But it's FlyQuest who have more men nearby. Quad is not really afraid of Zac 100 to zeroing him. Umti at least here to reinforce, make sure that Impact doesn't get taken out for nothing. Arrow flies through, but it won't strike true. Easy escape for Quad there, as he's just going to continue pushing the waves.
Yeah, they have the ward on the Krugs plus the Tri-Brush here, so he feels pretty confident, but Slingshot goes out.
Okay, Impact forcing the flash into the Corki. A TP coming in now from APA. Requiem hurts, but it doesn't really hurt enough to threaten a whole lot of anything. Kind of just a, hey, you guys don't want to keep this up. Warning ulti.
Yeah, back off. He got one Dark Harvest stack, so it's not the worst thing in the world to pop ultimate, but maybe TL see this as a possible opening. Hey, cooldown of the Karthus ulti gives him a little hope to do something.
Yep. Frozen Heart now completed for Bwipo as well. Skarner almost always wants to build health items, but I think in a game against three marksmen, building Frozen Heart still is going to feel pretty damn good, even if there is no health on the item. So I'm liking the purchases we're seeing so far up there in the top side from him. Again, the Sunfire Cape on impact is going to give you a lot of value against the Corki and the Senna, but it still feels bad when there's that Karthus who now has two items fully completed. He's got the Malignants, he's got the Liandries. This guy is going to hurt, man. And it's not just because of the fact that he's a mage into an armor builder. He's a mage with really high DPS, right? Like, this guy is scary for the Zac.
Yep, definitely would say that. Definitely should be quite frightened. Malignance. I guess it's hard to keep track of Karthus ultimates once you cut your malignance as well. So we'll see about that and see about the next move. Should line up there for FlyQuest with the dragon. Bwipo, though, on bottom side, 2v1.
Nice.
Two tanks on one.
Yep, they're trying to deal with Bwipo here, but I don't think Bwipo's really that afraid. I actually think that he feels pretty confident in this 1v2. You saw what he did there when Impact went to use the Elastic Slingshot on him. Bwipo can actually knock Zac out of his jump the same way that like a Janna Tornado or a Gragas Belly can, and you can just grab him in the air and slam him into the ground with a Stone Cold Stunner. It feels really cool to do, and that just means that Impact is going to have a hard time trying to engage on this guy unless he does it from the shadows, from the brush, right? So, still a 2,500 gold lead for FlyQuest. We got our next Drake spawning here in 15 seconds. Team Liquid has commanded both of the early Drakes so far. If they can grab this next one, they know that Soul Point would feel great. FlyQuest knows the same, and they want to make sure they stop it from happening. Nice slam into the wall from Bwipo there. APA has to rocket jump away. Meanwhile, Umti, now the target, flashing out of the way of the Ornhorn to guarantee that he stays alive. But Team Liquid now have no control over this bot lane. Meanwhile, topside APA drops to Bwipo. The Skarner will not be denied as he has the full Fimble winner. He has the Frozen Heart, and he has himself that kill on the enemy mid lane.
Yeah, the Skarner with all of the artillery on his team. Senna ultimate going through, and he calls down the orbital strike from the Karthus ulti, and they just kill APA. No Tristana, also no flash on the Tristana again. FlyQuest, easy time grabbing this Baron here, and honestly, they can try and run Team Liquid off the rest of the map. I mean, TL are trying to get some quick counter pushes in here.
Yep.
Hopefully they can scrape together some gold. Zac pushed on bottom side. Yeon's able to get the outer tower in mid. Impact wants to stick around for that outer gold here on bottom side and should be able to get it. Now they're retreating over to the Drake as well. About as good counterplay as you can have for TL for a Baron.
Yeah.
But now the Baron Siege Jump team is going to be coming for a lot of your territory of the map. But honestly, counterplay of two towers picked up, which were fairly low, plus the dragon for TL.
Look, it's a great counterplay to the enemy getting Baron, but counterpoint to your counterplay, the enemy still got Baron. And that's a pretty big problem 22 minutes into a game of League of Legends, as Bwipo and the rest of the FlyQuest boys are going to knock down this tier 2 here in the top lane. Red Bull Baron power play up to nearly 2,300 gold at this point. It's Busio back in the mid lane, getting this second lane primed and ready for another potential tier 2 push. AShe Arrow looking for Massu, but doesn't find him. Massu fast enough in the reactions there to avoid getting caught. Could have been in some serious trouble if not for that, but did still have the clan, so should have just been able to disengage anyway. As Inspired wants to escape, he picks up one of those Infernal Cinders to give him the extra little burst of move speed. As Busio now also joining back up. FlyQuest, they knew that Team Liquid wanted some kind of a punish there. They get away for now. Ornhorn coming in. Bwipo's ready to follow it up. He goes in for the pull. He has him locked down. Umti's going to be your first to die. And FlyQuest want more. APA and Impact looking maybe for a counterattack angle here, but Bwipo's coming in back over the wall with the E-stall Impact. CoreJJ and Yeon looking around for the flank. They aim to find it. Impact's here in the front. He's going to be popped into the passive right now. The Requiem comes down. Oh. But APA manages to grab a kill. He's trying to hop back out and kite away from Busio, but the knock up into the air might be enough. APA, he's killed in the rocket jump, and Bwipo's got Impact locked back down. Elastic Slingshot won't make the turn, he's gonna burn, and Bwipo is running him over. FlyQuest just aced him, and that was without Quad. Quad is on the inhibitor turrets, the Corki the whole time is killing TL's base while Skarner is running him over. Wowee! FlyQuest, it was looking dicey there for a minute as kills got traded back and forth. APA was scrambling to try to outplay there, but Team Liquid, now 8,000 gold behind, just didn't have the firepower.
Here's my question to you.
Now, yes, sir.
How long is Busio going to be on Ornn duty? Because the Ornn has been so good for him, so good for FlyQuest. These picks, Now, he picks and then he flashes over for the wall stun as well. But also later, he's the one that pins APA inside the alcove and takes out APA towards the end of the fight. I feel like Busio Ornn is very quietly, maybe for some, but very loudly for others, becoming like massive FlyQuest Bryo here. It was big in the first game, even though they lost. It has been big here as well. Although there are also other stars and other Skarner-like picks.
Guys, Skarner might be broken. You know, I honestly expected us to probably see our most Skarner picks of this split in week one, because once teams learn what he does, he will only be on the ban list.
Yeah, yeah. Skarner even got a little bit of nerf on this patch. We're on live patch, by the way.
Yup.
Oh, yeah.
Yup.
We are on post-nerf Skarner here.
That's my emote.
Yeah, it is. Skarner. This is post-nerf Skarner, so here you go. LCS on live patch, try this at home. Still good, still very, very good.
APA trying to get away there. Remember that Skarner, all four abilities have CC on them, but the Q and the W are only soft CC with the slows. You have to use the E or the R if you want to interrupt the teleport there, although he was able to ding him with the damage on that seismic bastion. It still doesn't matter. APA escapes with a nicely timed TP.
Also, people may, well, here we go.
Uh-oh, Requiem coming down. Umti flashing out of the way there of that Senna ulti, trying to stay alive. APA picking up a kill on Quad. It's a nice shutdown, but it will be traded 1-4-1. Massu there to guarantee they get their man.
So, Umti here, the general, I think as long as he just recalls, no one's going to go looking for him.
Nope, yes. Gone, gone, gone.
There's no way he puts it
right. No.
But these Karthus ultimates, Flowers, with the malignance in the build too, like Inspired has just been perma-farming while also delivering massive damage to the rest of the team. This is like a cooldown game for FlyQuest. Everyone take a deep breath after the craziness of the first game of this series. Since the early game of this this game went so well for them, they've been able to relax and feels like recollect themselves over the course of game number two here and set us up for what I'm gonna already say is a banger game number three. I mean, they are 7,000 gold ahead. There's a chance they could lose the soul somehow to something crazy like a weird steal.
Yeah.
But FlyQuest have such a massive advantage in the team fight. FlyQuest should just run at them when they come over towards the dragon and just grab one and go for the kills.
Yeah. Okay, Impact has not been spotted out here in this pixel rush just yet. The Karthus wall did not see him. The Maokai ulti flying in over the top. APA and Impact gonna work together. They find the instant kill onto Quad, who didn't realize Impact was waiting in the pixel. The Drake might have been secured from FlyQuest, but what about the follow-up fight? Bwipo's already down to half HP. Skarner's gonna be your target here at the very start.
If they lose
getting away with the Ishtal Impact, but Bwipo now coming back in here with the ulti, looking to turn this one back around. Umti down to 1/3. CoreJJ not gonna walk into the Skarner ulti. APA killing off Inspired, but the Requiem is still there. Team Liquid's health bars are decimated, and a massive dawning shadow forces Yeon back into the fight. Bwipo's chasing him down, and it's a rock to the face to guarantee it. Bwipo's still running, APA still gunning, Busio trying to take him back out. Bwipo over the wall, a double kill for Skarner. FlyQuest,
it's the best champion in the game.
It is. Thank you, me.
You were talking twice there. That was,
that was interesting. I don't know who that guy was. He looked pretty cool though. That was a cool costume.
I got double Flowers action, and we're gonna go, it looks like, pretty quickly into a game number three. FlyQuest, they're trying to clean up the rest of these inhibitors. They should at least get one inhibitor before retreating.
Nope.
And they will do just that. I was about to say, and you can see what Team Liquid were thinking with that chase. Mm-hmm. They got themselves one of probably a very rare positive situations in the game where they got the kill onto Quad, where Quad just jumped in. So it's a 4v5, and they're thinking, never mind.
Well, Flippo's going for the engage. He finds the ulti, but it's only onto the enemy top laner. FlyQuest, they got a couple of compromised health bars here, but they ain't afraid. They know they got Inspire coming up behind them. Massu's still firing from a long way away. Impact at 200 HP. Inspired and the rest of FlyQuest still chasing. Busio going for the Ornn Horn, wants the knockup. Here's your Requiem. Does this kill Impact right there? It knocks him into the passive at least, and it knocks everybody oh so low as Quad gets the kill on Umti. APA jumps in, but I think he might want back out. He takes two. APA will not go quietly. Yeon and Impact trying to put the finishing moves here on Busio, but as soon as Inspired shows up, they know it ain't gonna work. Bwipo comes back over the wall. He misses the rock, and Yeon is still fighting. Busio coming back in to help the boys out. APA jumping back over the wall. Inspired might die first. A beautiful ulti coming out from Bwipo. Looking to lock him down. Blow him up. Is it going to work? Not quite yet. APA, he will drop. Inspired's damage, even while dead, must be respected.
That was huge. Even though Inspired gets killed on the initiation from TL, he still got his body there. The corpse. Yep. The corpse is able to take them down because they have plenty of tanks there to keep the rest of TL members on that corpse. APA fighting his heart out here on the Tristana. Got the 2-for-1 explosive kill towards mid lane where he jumped back in.
That's huge.
Trying to make some heroics happen. And then almost was able to save the rest of the team and come up with that fight. But the OP, Skarner, was able to lock him down on top of the Karthus body to make it happen. Here's another look at it.
Yeah.
So APA is going in, he's like, you know what, we're gonna lose this game if I don't do something. So some heroics there, does get the double kill, and then after he's able to heal up, comes to join this long fight where Yeon is running for his life away from Inspired. Please get me away from this Karthus. And they almost made some hero comeback here, but FlyQuest still able to recover themselves and still able to bring this giant gold lead over to Baron.
This Karthus just feels like an unsolvable problem right now for Team Liquid. We've seen them have a couple of good fights now, but no matter how good it starts, it doesn't matter when Karthus R is gonna take half of everybody's health no matter what. And here it comes. Everybody on TL taking a massive chunk. CoreJJ with the burn and the malignancy. He's nearly dead just from the Requiem. Dawning Shadow will not hit him, but just the ulti plus the extra pressure from Massu, enough from FlyQuest to force TL back and secure the Baron for themselves.
Yeah, Bwipo threw a rock at him and popped the spell shield, and the spell shield was going to block and save you half your life, but then they popped the spell shield, so the ulti comes down and just blasts him, forces them to back off, and FlyQuest once again wearing another Baron buff and looking at another dragon spawn.
And
35 seconds ahead, they just have to defend it.
Bwipo coming back in here, seeing maybe for something in the bottom side. But I love the fact that you mentioned Bwipo throwing the rock to do that. Old Skarner couldn't participate in most game states, right? He would just try to flash ult somebody and that's all he does. New Skarner with the W spam and the rock throwing can contribute to so much in a poke war, in a standoff, trying to pop spell shields or check brushes. He has so much more value in those types of situations that people don't necessarily think of because they're thinking of direct head-to-heads and team fights and combat power. So I love the fact that that got to be showcased here in our first ever top lane Skarner game in the LCS, piloted by Mr. Bwipo, and it's only appropriate, Kobe, because Skarner is like the biggest champion in the game in size. Wide Bwipo should play wide Skarner.
They actually gave Skarner a wide rework.
Yes. Right.
They made the tails wider. There's three
he
tails.
He is the
now.
Widest now.
Now, wider, let's see.
Wider than he's ever been.
He
Skarner. Wide enough to hit the whole lane with one spell. And now Team Liquid are down 9,000 gold. They've lost the last two Drakes. They haven't been able to secure the soul. They can barely walk out of the base without this massive laser spawning over their heads and knocking off half their health.
Do you like rocks? Do you like scorpions?
I do.
Do you like being OP?
Yes.
And you like Skarner.
APA trying to get out. Here comes your Karthus ulti. Dawning Shadow's going to connect. APA is already down. And now the ulti onto Umti to bring him right back. Impact and Umti both heading for the hills. Without APA there, Team Liquid surely stands no chance against the game-ending push with a Baron off FlyQuest. First Nexus turret's already gone. Impact jumps in. He's slammed right back out. Masu's taking the kill. And FlyQuest want to pad those stats. They take out the second Nexus turret. They force Yeon back into the fountain. CoreJJ is going to be saved, but for how much longer? Team Liquid drop. FlyQuest are taking us to game number 3.
Thank you, Team Liquid. Thank you, FlyQuest. Thank you, Mark Zimmerman. We are going to go the full distance of
first
best of 3 of the LCS Summer 2024.
I think we learned this game, Kobe, that if you are playing red side in a game of League of Legends, you need to ban Skarner.
Okay. Because if you don't, you're probably playing against them. But do we need more data on that?
Well, I don't think Team Liquid's going to need a whole lot more data on it. Everybody in general, maybe. Maybe. Again, I expect teams to give it a shot, see if maybe they got a counter pick for it.
What about the Karthus issue and the early feeding of extra money into the Karthus pockets?
Yeah, I feel like a situation where the enemy team has Karthus and they can just kind of get away with a little bit of lane swap shenanigans, get him going, it feels pretty hard to deal with. Game number two is all wrapped up. Let's head on over.